In this second video clip, we're going to go through the remaining five types of water pollution. And again, just as a reminder, you should be able to define each type, note some examples, identify some sources, ideally both point sources and non-point sources, talk about the impacts of this sort of pollution, and then lastly, think of ideas for how we could reduce this sort of pollution. All right, let's take a look at sediment pollution. Sediment is another form of water pollution that is often misunderstood. Sediment consists of the clay, silt, and sand and gravel particles that are suspended in flowing water. When the water is moving, the particles are in the water column. And when the water slows down, the material is deposited. Common sources include mining areas, logging and road building operations, construction sites, as shown here, agricultural fields, and overgrazed lands. Which of these are point sources and which are non-point sources? How can these sources be reduced or eliminated? To see the impacts of sediment pollution, let's consider what happens when a water body goes from having a low sediment load to a high sediment load. Take a few moments to read through this slide and also notice the diverse substrate at the bottom of the water body and the plants that are growing there as well. Then consider what could happen to that environment with an increase in sediment pollution. Basically, light penetration is diminished, which reduces or eliminates bottom-dwelling plants, thus reducing oxygen levels in the water. Additionally, diminished visibility can impact organisms that rely on sight for hunting. When the sediment settles to the bottom of the lake or stream, it fills the cobble with mud and generally makes a more uniform substrate. As the complexity of the lake or stream bottom decreases, the potential niches decrease as well. Additionally, as organisms leave or perish, those that depend on them are also affected. Our next type of pollution is organic compounds. Organic chemicals generally include any substance with a carbon-hydrogen bond. There are many, many examples of organic chemicals, including gasoline, oil, pesticides, solvents, industrial chemicals, steroids, hormones, medications, etc. Sources can vary. Industrial releases, leaky underground storage tank, roads and lawn runoff, effluent from a wastewater treatment plant, and more. Can you think of sources that are point sources and also sources that are non-point sources? The impacts of organic chemical pollutants can vary depending on the pollutant. Some are toxic. Some may cause developmental problems or birth defects. Also, you may want to review the effects of endocrine disruptors that we studied earlier in the course. Notably, though, most organic chemicals will increase the biological oxygen demand. Essentially, that means there are likely bacteria that will partially or completely degrade the substance, and these decomposers require oxygen. As the decomposers work, the oxygen levels decline. Thus, just as with eutrophication, dead zones may occur. We've noted that the dead zone in the Gulf of Mexico is likely due to eutrophication, but certainly organic compounds will also play a role. Another class of water pollutants is inorganic chemicals. Inorganic chemicals are not organic, so generally they contain elements other than carbon, or more precisely, they don't contain carbon-hydrogen bonds. Inorganic chemical pollutants include salts, some acids, and a wide variety of heavy metals. Sources vary and include industrial contamination from factories. Think of Flint, Michigan, for example. Deposition of airborne pollution, for example, mercury from coal-burning power plants. Historic contamination from past industries, for instance, the use of mercury to extract gold during the gold rush. And we still have that mercury present in San Francisco Bay. and then also mining, runoff from roads, etc. Which of these sources are point sources and which are non-point sources? And can you think of additional sources? As with the organic chemicals, the effects of inorganic chemicals vary depending on the chemical. Many of the heavy metals are especially hazardous to humans and other animals' health. Notably, lead and mercury are neurotoxins, causing retardation and other brain and nervous system illnesses. The term Mad Hatter, remember the character in Alice in Wonderland, comes from the fact that hatters, that is, people that make hats, typically went mad. That is, they developed mental illnesses. Hatters, it turned out, used mercury to treat leather to fashion hats. Mercury was also widely used to extract gold during California's gold rush, and as a result, there's a large amount of historic mercury contamination in the Sierra Nevada rivers and the San Francisco Bay. Another issue with metals is that they tend to bioaccumulate. They are taken in with food but not excreted, so they build up in fatty tissue. Additionally, they tend to biomagnify, so predators at the top of the food chain, like swordfish and tuna, can have extremely high concentrations. I encourage you to review the two concepts of bioaccumulation and biomagnification. They were presented in Chapter 3 in your textbook. Our next type of pollution, thermopollution, is another form of water pollution that most people don't even pause to consider. It simply involves raising or lowering the water temperature from normal levels, usually raising. Sources of heat include industrial effluent from industry, cooling water from power plants, and simply the removal of shading trees in riparian areas during logging and road building. Again, consider which of these are point sources and which are non-point sources. The impacts of thermal pollution include species decline or elimination due to range of tolerance issues. And remember that at different stages in the life cycle of a fish or an insect, they may have different tolerances for temperature. Another impact is the creation of artificial environments that might make it more suitable for some invasive species to come in. Or it might disrupt migration patterns, which can affect other ecosystems across the globe. For example, downstream from the power plant in my hometown in Minnesota, there is now a year-round population of geese because the river does not freeze over as it normally would have. You might think, big deal, there's geese here now, but it can have disruptive effects both on the local ecosystems and then on the ecosystems from which they are now absent. Another important issue is the oxygen depletion that occurs. Warmer water holds less oxygen than cooler water, so you might have range of tolerance issues not only for temperature, but also for the amount of oxygen in the water. Some fish may not be able to survive in the warmer water because there's not enough oxygen present. Trout, salmon, steelhead are all fish that require a lot of oxygen. Catfish, on the other hand, and carp, they can come right up to the surface to gulp oxygen, so they're likely to find it favorable conditions for them. Lastly, radioactive pollution is the emission of radiation from unstable isotopes. Sources include mines and mine tailings, industrial waste from power plants, the weapons industry, nuclear power plants, and hospitals, nuclear accidents, like the recent Fukushima accident in Japan, and also natural sources. Which of these sources are point sources and which are non-point sources? Interestingly, thinking of the Fukushima disaster, scientists predicted that we would be able to start to measure radioactive isotopes from that disaster along California's coastline starting in about April of 2014, and indeed that did occur. It's just a reminder that pollution does not stay contained within political boundaries. As for the impacts of radioactive substances, well, clearly they're toxic and teratogenic and mutagenic. And also we have to remember that these substances are going to stay around for hundreds or thousands or 10,000s, or in some cases millions of years. To add complexity to deducing effects and figuring out cleanup strategies, often water is polluted by more than one type of pollution. Sewage, for example, often contains three or four or more of the types of pollution that we listed. Which of the seven types of pollution that we listed are present in sewage? Your textbook notes that identifying the types and sources of pollution is the first step in cleaning up a polluted waterway. Water testing can identify the contaminants, but finding the sources is often more difficult. Generally, a watershed approach is used. Typically, the watershed is mapped, and investigators look up gradient to find the source or sources. Water flows downhill, both above ground and below ground. So you need only look up gradient from the pollution to find its source. Notably, to review, a watershed is all the land area that contributes water to a particular stream. This is an important definition. Commonly, students mistakenly state it's where the water flows to. No, it is more accurate to say it is where the water flows from. Synonyms for watersheds include catchment and drainage basin. Study the diagram here and confirm that you understand the concept of a watershed and that you understand how a watershed approach can help find the source of pollutants. Lastly, what can each of us do to have a positive impact on local water quality? Turns out there's a lot that each and every one of us can do to prevent water pollution. Your textbook gives lots of great examples for reducing stormwater runoff. I encourage you to review their ideas shown here. Notably, some of that stormwater can be stored for later irrigation use and/or allowed to infiltrate into the groundwater, thus limiting flooding and water pollution and the use of other pristine water sources. In addition to improved stormwater management, there's still lots of other things that you can do. Conserve water and be efficient with your water. Anything you can do to use less water means less runoff and/or less wastewater to be treated at your local wastewater treatment plant. Also, consume less stuff. All the stuff that you buy was made somewhere, and there was likely water used and pollution produced in the process. Use less energy and drive less. Power plants use and add heat to a huge amount of water. Your car leaves oils, gases, metals, and other substances right on the roadway. Additionally, particles from car exhaust are ultimately deposited back on the soil or in our water sources. You can use non-toxic cleaners, and only in small amounts. These would be less chemicals for the wastewater treatment plant to treat. Plant drought-tolerant native plants. This leads to less runoff off your yard, driveway, and street. Use less fertilizers and pesticides, or better yet, don't use any or use organic fertilizers and pesticides. Less runoff off your yard or into the groundwater is going to mean less pollution. You can also volunteer with a local stream or bay restoration group. There's plenty of opportunities here in the San Francisco Bay Area. And of course, help spread the word by educating your friends and family that reducing water pollution is something that we can all actively participate in every day with our choices.